the advocacy officer for Musasa.
As Musasa, our advocacy has been centering around gender-based violence against women and girls in Zimbabwe. And we are saying we are working with policy level makers, we are working with local leadership, we are working with various actors, taking a multi-sectoral approach in our advocacy initiatives. So at the local level, we have local level advocacy, where we are saying the people in the communities take responsibility for the change that they want to see in the societies in terms of gender-based violence. And also at local leadership, it is up to the local leaders to take a stand against gender-based violence in their communities by sensitizing communities and mobilizing communities so that they stand together against gender-based violence. At the national level, we are looking at policy makers, the parliamentarians. We are also looking at such actors as religious leaders. We are also looking at such actors as line ministries, where we are saying as Musasa, we work together in order to refine the policies that we have, in order to make recommendations, in order to come with policy briefs in enhancing our response and service delivery to the women and girls who are affected by gender-based violence. Okay, as you might understand that the COVID pandemic is a unique and it's a novel virus that we do not understand at the moment, and the mechanisms that each country is taking in order to curb this pandemic is quite different, and some of it then impacts negatively on the women and girls who are facing gender-based violence. As you might understand, during this time, gender-based violence is on the rise because people are staying together, they are locked in with abusers, the home becomes an incubation hub for violence, and because of the tightening economic situations in the country, you find that families are really finding it difficult to harmoniously and peacefully resolve their conflicts, such that gender-based violence is on the increase. However, in terms of service delivery, we find that we are facing a myriad of challenges in terms of women accessing the service posts where they want to be assisted. They are facing challenges in transportation, for example. It's no longer easy to travel to a service post because you need a letter, for example, to travel. You need to explain again why you are traveling at that particular time. So, for example, if I've been sexually abused, I might not have that letter. And when I go to a roadblock, I might be asked, interrogated even, where are you going? Why do you want to go there? And then it becomes difficult for any woman to then say, I've been sexually molested, I've been raped, I want to go and access a service. This might also be very, very difficult. Again, in terms of communication, you find that most of the women that we interact with as Musasa, they are not privileged in terms of having smartphones so that they can access information of where to get the various services that they need. So in principle, they are left out in terms of accessing information, in terms of also being able to negotiate for the services that they need at this particular time. So we find that the COVID-19 has brought different and unique challenges to the women affected by gender-based violence. Yeah, as Musasa, we are really advocating, we are lobbying, we are negotiating with policymakers that at least gender-based violence be taken or declared as an emergency during this COVID-19 period. And this will ensure that also resources are channeled towards gender-based violence service delivery. Again, we are having discussions around, as an organization, also providing transport support. In other areas, we do have a shuttle where it can carry survivors to access the different services that they may need. So again, it's another area that we have quickly responded to. Again, we are working with other partners to raise awareness, to let the women know that they have Musasa during this time, they can call us at any time on our toll-free lines. They can talk to us on WhatsApp. They can talk to us on Facebook, on text it, on our WhatsApp chat box. In that line, we have also increased our toll-free lines so that we can reach more women who need our support. So we have been very present during this time, online and offline, and we want to reach so many women so that they can access the services. We introduced mobile services where we are actually going into the community because we realize the restrictive movement measures that are there in place might restrict the women from coming to receive services at our offices. So we have taken it upon ourselves as Musasa to start a very robust program on mobile services that are actually going into the communities and providing the critical service that the women and girls need at this particular time. As part of our advocacy initiatives as well, we in the last quarter we have met with parliamentarians, with commissions, with government ministries, and policymakers in Mutare, Blawayo, and Harare in order for us to discuss the issues around service delivery during this COVID-19 period. And we are confident and we were assured with the parliamentarians present that definitely they will look into the issues that we raised, and we continue our lobbying, we continue our advocacy as Musasa, and we want to believe that we do have people who are ready to listen to us, and in the near future we do hope that the fight that we are fighting against gender-based violence will soon be realized. So to Zimbabwe, my call is that find peaceful ways of resolving conflict. As Musasa, we respect the human dignity, we respect the human rights of women and girls, and we want women and girls to feel safe in Zimbabwe.
My name is Tinashe Shotunu. I'm a human rights practitioner and a lawyer by profession. I am currently working as a resident lawyer at Harare Musasa One Stop Center. There are various legal instruments that are available that protect women from violence, both in the public and private sphere. We've got the Constitution, Section 52, highlights the right to personal security, both in the private and public sphere. We've also got the Domestic Violence Act, which actually affords a survivor protection in terms of a protection order or a peace order. We've also got the Criminal Codification Act, which lists various crimes against women, such as rape. We also have the Maintenance Act, which affords women an opportunity to get recourse in terms of economic abuse. Musasa Legal Aid Clinic offers a range of services. First and foremost, we provide survivors with legal advice on how they can use the law to protect themselves and prevent further abuses. We also offer drafting services whereby we assist women in drafting legal documents that they present at the court. We also assist women in actually responding. Some of the women we get who have been served different legal documents, and we assist women in responding to those legal documents. We also refer women to other partners to get further legal assistance. Finally, we also provide awareness in terms of the legal instruments and the rights available to women. Generally, survivors are already facing challenges at the home front. There are norms, customs, practices and behaviors that have continued to perpetuate the culture of violence. So we see that most women actually do not report their cases of violence for fear of retribution or to be ostracized by the family and even the community. So it is now even further difficult for women to report during COVID time because they are locked down with the perpetrators. Those norms and customs and practices continue to exist around them. and they do not have the knowledge of how they can assist themselves in getting legal services and actually accessing those institutions that provide those services. During lockdown, what the pandemic has done is to restrict women's movement. Hence, women are actually facing a difficult time in accessing services at offices like Musasa and other civil society organizations. Also, we see that the need for a clearance letter is one of the impediments to accessing services at either the courts or even organizations like Musasa. And finally, the lockdown has actually limited the amount of services being provided by service providers, whereby there are shortages of staff. So we see women are facing a torrid time in accessing services. Furthermore, as Musasa, we have noted that it has been difficult for women to actually access services such as courts due to closures or a shortage of staff. For example, during the first phase of the lockdown, we see that courts were closed and they were only entertaining cases of emergencies. However, when courts were opened, there was no clear communications to say that the courts were now opened and that women could access those services. In light of the various challenges that women face during this COVID pandemic, Musasa has endeavored to actually continue providing legal services to our survivors and clients through the various forms of medias. For example, Musasa is providing legal awareness through our Facebook and website. We are also providing legal services through the toll-free lines that are available and the social platforms such as the WhatsApp platform and Facebook. In our national areas, we are providing mobile clinics whereby survivors can access a one-stop center and actually receive legal services through our paralegals. I'd like to urge Zimbabweans to use our laws that are there to prevent and protect each citizen from violence, and also to reach out where they're experiencing any forms of violence to organizations like Musasa.